ladies and gentlemen, settle in for a trip to Mars in body, mind and soul. Please welcome your guide to the Red Planet, Mr. Josh Richards.
There we go. The magic of theatre. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Becoming Martian. This evening we are going on a journey of body, mind and soul to the Red Planet to explore how human beings will change by exploring Mars. My name is Josh Richards and I'm actually a candidate to the first human mission to Mars. I get a lot of questions about this. I have a lot of people turn around and sort of say, how will you live on Mars? You know, will there be cows? Do things get recycled? There will not be cows on Mars because they generate an extraordinary amount of methane. And it'll be hideous when the entire thing explodes. We'll be having fun. But the biggest question I get is, why would you want to go? Why would you want to leave Earth behind and explore a whole new planet? So rather than giving you a straight answer, I want to introduce you to some of the other candidates who have put their hands up to go to Mars with me and have them explain why.
Mars has been a source of inspiration for explorers.
They'd like to meet Chewbacca.
I want to go to Mars because I believe
they have a beard that doesn't belong on this planet.
We can continue to thrive as a species, and it is also a platform for further space exploration.
They have gigantic hair that would never fit inside the capsule.
One day being, you know, a colonist on another world, because we are trying to colonize another world.
I would like to help further my species.
I have nothing to contribute on this woman whatsoever. I'm going to buy this man a better microphone.
And I want to go to Mars to make a home.
Probably in a cave.
My future for family, for humanity itself.
It is not only important to explore.
This man genuinely terrifies me every time I watch the video.
I believe the Mars One's mission is the greatest opportunity that humanity has to take the next giant leap into becoming a multi-planetary species.
And he's just a deluded idiot. Now, we had 200,000 people apply to the Mars One project last year between April and August. As you can see up here, 202,586 maniacs decided that they wanted to go on a mission to Mars. Mars One then cut the group down between the end of August and the end of December last year to 1,058 people that they thought might be appropriate. So I'm one of the 99.5%. No, I'm part of the 0.05% people that managed to survive, and we culled the rest of the group. From there, we're all sent off for medicals, and of that, we lost another 353 people as well. So the current group is down to just 705 candidates worldwide to go to Mars. If you have a look up there, you can see that there's a slight majority of men that are still in the running. That's far better than it used to be, because it used to be 99% men when they first started out. So they've kind of balanced things out. A lot of guys trying to leave Earth. But that's last year. That's where we were in the past. What I want to talk to you about now is the future. So let me tell you about the mission. You can see here, blue skies, green plants. We're still living on Earth. This is a mock-up colony of where essentially we'll be training, because the 705 people who are still currently in the running are hoping to be one of the 24 that are selected for the 9 years of training that it'll take to prepare before we go to Mars. We'll be spending a lot of time in something like this, 3 months at a time, in fact, where we'll be practicing, working with the systems that are involved, learning how to repair things, learning how to do dentistry on each other, all sorts of horrifying things. It'll be fun. 9 years of training, locked away in these things for 3 months at a time. In 2018, Mars One wants to send its first lander to Mars. This is essentially a scout that will search out and try and find the best sources of water while we're looking for Mars. Obviously, there's no water on the surface of Mars, so if you have a look there on the front, there's a scoop behind the right-hand solar panel, which is essentially to dig up some dirt and throw that dirt into an oven that'll heat it back up to try and find out if there's water in the dirt that they land on. In 2021, we'll be sending the first supply capsule. This is essentially a way to test all the systems so that when we do try and land people later on, they don't just die on impact. This particular supply capsule will probably be carrying quite a bit of water and quite a bit of food supplies as well, just as backup. Because between 2021 and 2024, we'll be sending six more of them. just basically building the colony up. We'll be sending two rovers along with it as well. Those rovers will lay out solar panels and they'll start connecting everything up. The idea being that we have a fully functioning colony with no one living in it before human beings even launch towards the red planet. Because in September 2024, four people will be selected to head towards Mars. They'll be undergoing a 210-day mission to get from Earth to Mars, hurtling through the darkness of space. And when they get there, they'll be loading off into that tiny little capsule on the end there and descending onto Mars. Arriving in April 2025, the first human footsteps on another planet. Now, 600 million people watched the Apollo landings. But that was 1969. It was an era where TVs weren't as common as they are now. And these days, everyone walks around with a computer in their pocket in the form of a smartphone. So it's Mars One's hope that instead of 600 million people, there's potential for 6 billion people to witness the first footfall on another planet. Now, exploring space is dangerous and really ridiculously expensive. NASA has priced the idea of a mission to Mars in 2035, 10 years after our mission, at nearly $1 trillion. It's just extraordinary, the amount of money that's involved with it all. Mars One, on the other hand, is currently talking about landing people on Mars for $6 billion. And there's one really, really important reason why they can do it so much more cheaply than NASA can. It's because we're not coming back home. When we get there, we'll stay on Mars for the remainder of our lives, be that 4 seconds after impact or 4 decades when we die of old age. We'll live out the rest of our lives on the surface of Mars with no hope of return. Currently, the technology exists and has existed for some decades to get people to Mars, but what we haven't had is the technology to bring people back again. So Mars One has cut out the return trip and just said, we'll just keep them there. And the best part about it for all of you people who stay here on Earth, get to watch it on TV as well. So this is less Big Brother in space and more like Meerkat Manor. So I'm essentially going to have my life narrated by David Attenborough while I continue to fail to populate with the other colonists. It's going to be fun. It'll be fun watching me dismally fail and then have it replayed over and over again and remixed on YouTube. But I understand why a lot of people might sort of flinch at the idea of going one way to Mars. But for many, many people, the idea of going into space is incredibly appealing. This idea of witnessing our gorgeous blue planet from above, being able to see that there's no borders. When you look down from space, there's no nations, there's no borders, it's just one gorgeous blue Earth that we all share, protected by this wafer-thin atmosphere that's less than 30 kilometres thick. You go up more than 30 kilometres, the atmosphere has become that thin that your blood boils, that you pass out long before that because of lack of oxygen, but literally fluids boil off at body temperature. We are protected by such a wafer-thin atmosphere. And people want to witness that. They want to go up and they want to be able to see the Earth from space. Now, you should be able to do it by the end of next year, because we're talking about Virgin Galactic having the opportunities of space tourism, essentially sending people up to go and witness the Earth from above, get about 8 minutes of weightlessness, and then come back down again in less than an hour. For those of us that can't afford the $500,000 that it costs for the 1 hour trip to go up into space, there's another option. We've always got Kerbal Space Program. Is anyone here familiar with Kerbal Space Program? It's an incredibly expensive computer game at $30, which is essentially an incredibly accurate physics generator, which allows you to launch Kerbals, these adorable little green Despicable Me type characters, into space using realistic physics and realistic rocket engines. Would anyone like to try and launch a rocket into space with Kerbal Space Program? Yeah? I tell you what, we've got a little guy down here. Do you reckon you could launch a rocket into space? No? I'll give it to you then. Come on down. Seriously, we're going to launch it up. I've got Kerbal Space Program running in the background here. Have you played Kerbal Space Program before? No. You're about to. Right. So, jump on here.
Oh. Okay.
Very simple controls. Left, right, up and down. And what you want to do is keep that in the middle. I'll throttle up for you. And when we hit spacebar, you sure? Yeah, you should launch straight away. Right. Now, rockets are naturally quite loud, so I have to yell. Apologies to the people filming if it's booming. Hit spacebar again, and away we go. As you can see, we've burnt some of our fuel building up the rockets initially at the start there. What we're going to do is those rockets around the outside are going to burn initially, and then they're going to start breaking away off in series. So as you see those two small ones about to run out of fuel there, as soon as they do, hit spacebar again and they'll drop away. Now. Yep. And away they go. So this is what we call a four-stage rocket launch. We've got four stages. One rocket through the middle, that central fuel tank that's providing all the fuel for one huge rocket engine at the bottom. And then three stages around the outside. As we keep going up, you can see we've just crossed 1.2 kilometers up into the air. And our little blue bar at the top there shows us how thick the atmosphere is. So at this stage, you can still breathe quite safely. We're still on dead track. If you hit M for a second, that goes out to our view there, so you can see Earth from above. And if we zoom in, you should also be able to see that we've got to hit M again. See that little curve that we've got? We're going dead straight up. The thing is, the Earth is rotating around underneath us, so you start to get a trajectory that goes as well. Now, if we just went straight up, eventually it would start to rotate around. But instead, what we're going to do is we're going to tilt towards the same direction that the Earth's rotating, so we can start to go around in an orbit. We roughly start to do that turn at the 5 kilometer mark. So what I'm going to ask you to do is, using the D, I want you to aim so that the yellow mark lines up with the 90 degree ball there. So we're going to tilt over, starting now. And you see our rocket gently start to tilt over. Be gentle with it. And we're starting to tilt over to the 90 degree point so we can start to arc over around the planet. We're still going up. We're still racing away at 160 meters a second, accelerating up into the air. So if you stop there and hold that pattern there, and we'll start to orbit around. Beautiful. If you hit M again, and you'll see, as we accelerate up further and further, that mark will continue to move further and further. That mark is essentially what would happen if we stopped the engines right now and where it would land again. You also see there's a little arrow halfway along the point. That's called what we call the apothesis. It's the point that's the furthest away from the Earth. If we get a proper orbit going, that will change its name to the apogee of the orbit. And the other point, the orbit point that is closest to the surface of the Earth, is called the perigee as well. So orbits have different shapes. They're not all circular. If we go back for a second, hit M. Yep. So we've tilted right over at this stage. We're racing away around. But we still need to climb a little bit higher. So if you go and hit A, and you should tilt it back up so that you get to, you want to line up on that point there. So we've tilted over a little bit too far, and all we're going to do is crash into the water again. But at this point, go for that there. We've also got the yellow circle there. That's the direction that our rocket's actually traveling. We might be pointing in one direction, but we've built up momentum in one particular vector or another, and they'll continue going that way. So just because you point one direction in a rocket doesn't mean you're necessarily going to go that way. And we're twisting and doing all sorts of stuff. That's all right. I tell you what, if you hit spacebar again, it's all right, dude. This is the first time he's ever played it. We'll drop a few more and go again. Spacebar again. We'll drop a few more. So we just got our main rocket engine there. And it's rocking and rolling. Launching rockets is hard. And to be honest with you, I haven't turned a couple of systems on just to make sure that he crashed. So it's not cruel. It's funny. It's fine. Yeah.
Your flint's sitting on the table.
Ah, thank you. Cool. So if you can see there, got a little bit of red. You can see a little bit of a flicker there. That's because we've still got quite a thick atmosphere that we're trying to race through. We're getting faster and faster and faster, and we're still in the atmosphere, which is why we climb up higher before we start our orbits. So what we might do there, if I hit, that cuts it out there. We're going to break away and throttle up again. We've got our little capsule, which we're going to cut away again. It's all gone horribly wrong. Listen, I'm not blaming you because I'm pushing the buttons, but I will blame you.
Yeah.
Basically, this is the Russian space program in on screen right now. We're going to end it there because I don't want a bunch of kids watching three kerbals explode on a giant screen. But
would you want me to bring it in?
Yes, please.
Yeah.
Right. Give us a round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. Yay! Fantastic. Now, back to... So, going into space is a bit of fun, unless, you know, of course, you explode. But genuinely, usually it's good fun. And you can see, even weightlessness is good fun. So, like, all these people are having a pretty good grand time, except for the dude on the right. I don't know what his problem is. But, I mean, the guy next to him, he looks like he's had an aneurysm. He's having that much fun. The guy down the bottom here, he's screaming at the camera. She's laughing at him screaming. They're having a good time. Weightlessness is pretty cool. And, I mean, if you manage to ever do this, this is the Zero-G Corporation. They take people out on these parabolic flights and basically give them an opportunity to experience weightlessness for about 20 or 30 seconds at a time. It looks like extraordinary amount of fun. And they even managed to get a smile out of Stephen Hawking's, which is pretty incredible. Weightlessness is a lot of fun for about the first hour or so. But the all-important but, all of this was based out of the first aircraft that were developed to essentially train the Mercury and Gemini astronauts back in the 50s and 60s. So essentially what they did, they padded the inside of a transport aircraft, did these big loop-de-loops. So you can see they scoop up, they experience about 1.8 Gs during the climb, so it's literally like having your stomach trying to come out through your feet while you're pinned to the floor. And then at the top of the roller coaster, you roll over and you have it all come back up again. So it's good for the first hour or so, but as I said, you know, these guys having a good time. These guys, they usually went up there for about 4 or 5 hours, so there's a really good chance that these guys are seconds away from filling their helmets with lunch. After a little while, it's a little unpleasant. But once you actually get to space, things start to chill out a little bit more. You don't have the roller coaster rocking up and down. Things become a little more comfortable. You can see here, this is Catty Coleman. She was on the International Space Station in 2011. Catty's having a pretty good time. And, like, I'll be honest with you, Catty in this photo is 51, and she's looking pretty good. Like, that hair's amazing. She's got a great big smile. That what the reality is when you go up into space, because our bodies are so used to being in 1G of gravity, when you go up, all the fluids shift up in your body. So for the ladies, they become bustier. The guys look like they've got bigger shoulders. All the wrinkles come out of your face as well. It's a bit of a day spa. Gives your joints a break because they're not working so hard. The effect where it all sort of, everything shifts up, all the fluids shift up, lasts a few days. And for some people, it makes them quite unwell. It's called space adaptation sickness. But for the most part, it's a bit of a day spa and it makes everyone look younger and healthier than they usually are. The problem, of course, is when they come back to Earth.
And I figured that would never happen.
Now, this is Heidi Marie. She's just come back off her first flight to space and she's at a press conference. And Chris Hadfield saves the day. Right, and down she goes. Readjusting to gravity back here on Earth can be quite challenging because you've literally gotten used to having all these fluids moving around up in your upper body and they rush back down to your feet again. So you end up having dizzy spells, you end up having all sorts of nausea. We're in America, so we cheer when people stand up. That's all right, she continues on with a press conference and everything's well. Look at her.
Wait, that's not a little embarrassing.
Bit of a glib remark, you know, oh, whoops, that was a shame. bit of a laugh.
So I don't get people worrying standing up here too long. Think what I was going to say, and so I figure I can stand here standing enough.
And down she goes again. Yep. Ah, it's just cruel now. Now I'm just making you watch the woman fall over and over and over again. But yet Heidi Murray collapsed twice during the press conference, literally because of the weightlessness. And as I said, here on Earth, everything's exactly where it's supposed to be. Initially, when you go up into space, all the fluids shift up into your body, so you do look younger and all those sort of things. After a little while, it starts to go down, but you still have quite a bit of fluid up in your chest. As I said, the problem is when you come back down into 1G, where it all drops down to your legs again and people collapse. Your heart has become weaker from not having to work so hard in space, so it can't pump the blood back up to your brain. So you have astronauts collapsing at press conferences afterwards. To try and get astronauts used to the zero-G environment, they spend a lot of time underwater. As this is a extravehicular activity, there's essentially a neutral buoyancy facility in Texas where astronauts have the opportunity to train on a full-scale mock-up of the International Space Station to see where everything goes, how things move in zero-G, and essentially become familiar with the idea of moving around outside in the vacuum of space. This is an astronaut that's actually moving around what is essentially a 400-kilo ammonia pump that is on the International Space Station, but because it's neutral buoyancy, he can move it around just as easily. What it doesn't replicate, however, is what it looks like in space, and not just for the obvious reason of you're inside the bottom of a pool, but because of the refractive index difference between water and air, he looks like he's got a tiny little head there. And the reality is, for him, it looks like he's inside a giant fishbowl, because you can't see what's going on. Everything's twisted, everything's moved out of place. So it can be incredibly disorientating and actually easier to move things around in actual space as opposed to the bottom of a pool. The guy who essentially came up with this idea of training astronauts to move around in space by doing it underwater is this guy. And you probably don't recognise him, but it's the second man on the moon. This is Buzz Aldrin during the Gemini program. And this is Buzz taking the very first space selfie. It's become quite a thing recently, but Buzz beat them all to it in 1967 by taking the first space selfie. I have a lot of people ask me what would happen if Buzz here was outside in the vacuum of space without a suit on. And it's a little more complicated than what people think. They think, oh, you just freeze or you die, but there's literally no pressure in space. So there's no temperature means nothing. The reality is, if you still had a way to breathe somehow, but you weren't wearing a suit, you'd probably end up looking more like this guy. Now, the reality is we have an atmosphere of pressure keeping all our bodies in place. We've got fluids and gases in our blood, and without that pressure, everything expands. So the reality is you end up looking like a bodybuilder by going out into space. Not pleasant, because you know, you're literally having your body swell to twice the size of what it is, but you'd probably end up looking like Arnie here. Now, there's only three men who've genuinely been exposed to the hard vacuum of space, and it's these three cosmonauts here who were part of Soyuz 11. And in fact, they are the only three human beings who've ever died in space. While we've had accidents, we've had astronauts die in accidents and various different things, the official limit for space is 100 kilometres, and the only three people who've ever died were the members of Soyuz 11. They went up to dock with the Salyut 1, the world's very first space station, and as part of the de-docking process, a valve was knocked open and the inside of the capsule completely decompressed. So for a couple of minutes, these guys looked a little bit like Arnie, and then they shrunk back down again once they got to Earth. And in fact, the crews that recovered them couldn't work out what was wrong with them, couldn't work out why these men were dead, because there was nothing visibly wrong with them. Now, as I said, you end up looking like Arnie if you get exposed to space, but that's only if your body's still fluid, full of all the fluids. If you've spent more time in space, like I said, you wind up looking like that guy if you've been up there for a short period of time. If you've lost all those fluids out of your system because you've been up in space for an extended period of time, you look more like this guy instead. Seriously, ET, it's horrifying. You're still wrinkly and all sorts of things because you've lost all the fluids out of your body. So I suppose the real question is, Why would you want to do that? Like, why would you risk your life? What kind of person does it take to sign up? What sort of maniac in particular would sign up to want to leave the planet behind forever? And it's interesting, it's an interesting question to ask, because a lot of people automatically assume that it would be the everyday astronauts. The kind of person that you want to send to Mars would be someone who's already trained to live in space. And that's not the case, because I want to tell you a story about another astronaut who was an amazing naval aviator. She was an incredible incredible woman, amazing achievements. Name's Lisa Nowak. Now, Lisa here was a NASA astronaut during the shuttle program. Incredibly capable aviator, incredibly capable and intelligent woman. But you probably don't recognize her from this photo. You probably recognize her from this one, just after she was arrested for trying to kidnap and murder the woman that was sleeping with the woman that she was sleeping with. You see, the reality is, being an astronaut means hiding a whole lot of stuff. You have to be this perfect astronaut, this perfect individual without fault. So you don't necessarily want to go up into space and be locked away with little Lisa Nowak for the rest of your life on Mars. So instead, Mars One have turned around and they've come up with five characteristics. Rather than looking for people who are already trained as astronauts, they've tried to come up with five different characteristics that they want from each of their potential colonists. So the first one is resiliency. You need someone who can turn around and go, okay, fine. Bob's left the airlock open. We've lost half the colony, but we'll deal with it. We'll be fine. Okay, we'll come to terms with this. It's fine. We might push Bob out the airlock at some later stage, but, you know, we'll move on and it'll be okay. They need people who can adapt and sort of go, okay, yeah, we have lost half the colony. Good job, Bob. We'll probably end up eating you at some later stage, but, you know, we can adapt. We'll reroute systems. We'll make things work as well. You need people who are curious, people who will turn around and go, what is that green thing under a rock moments before they're eaten? People who will go out and explore and let's turn over this rock, let's go down to this valley. Yeah, sure, let's find out what happens when we light the atmosphere on fire. People who are curious about their lives. The ability to trust. You don't want to be locked away with little Sarah who keeps stealing your toothbrush so she can clean the toilet. Like, you need people who you can actually trust and work with on a regular basis. And you need people who are creative and resourceful, because when Bob leaves the airlock open and Sarah keeps using your toothbrush to clean the toilet, you need to be able to make art about it and be able to express your feelings and be resourceful and go, you know what, I don't need that toothbrush afterwards. I'll use this old piece of grass that we've grown in some god-awful habitat. Can anyone think of someone that might fit these five attributes of being able to be resilient, adaptable, curious, be able to trust people and be resourceful and creative? I can think of one person, and it's someone who travels widely, who knows how to coil rope, fix electronics, be able to play with laser beams, wrap things around gear sticks, I don't know what that is, use Swiss Army knives, weld, play with light, and use a microwave effectively. Who we really need is MacGyver. We need to send MacGyver to space. And essentially, we need four people who know how to do a really good barrel roll. But seriously, we can't just have any ordinary MacGyvers. We need MacGyvers who can also live in somewhere like that. Now, this is the Mars 500 experiment. It was a facility that was built just outside of Moscow. And it was essentially an experiment locking six men away for 520 days. Don't know why they didn't just call it Mars 520, but they called it Mars 500. They locked them away for 520 days on a simulated Mars mission. The idea was to simulate the time that it would take to get to Mars, spending 1 month on the surface of Mars, in which they had a small room that was set up like the surface of Mars with dirt and rovers and things like that that they went and did their little experiments on. And then they had to get back into a room again and get locked away for an extended period of time in order to come back to Earth. The whole thing was run from a facility outside Moscow, but for the purposes of the way that it was being run, those men were essentially on a mission to Mars for 520 days. And they're looking quite happy here. They're looking like they're having a grand time. This is actually a photo taken right at the start. because being locked away and isolated from people does people's heads in, and it does weird things to our bodies as well. So for the Japanese researcher who was on the end there, he was down to about 2 hours sleep a night by the end of the 520 days. It just completely destroyed his sleep pattern. For some of the other crew members, they put on considerable amounts of weight because basically they turned into fat computer nerds while they played Nintendo Wii all the time. That was the only way to keep themselves sane, was to continue to play computer games. So, again, why would you do this? Why would you sign up to risk life and limb, to turn into someone who's essentially lethargic, sits around and doesn't want to get up out of bed all day, because that's what these guys turned into, couch potatoes. Why would you want to do that? Where is the appeal? Like, why go to Mars in the first place? There's the real question. Why not just stay here on Earth? Earth's nice. We have air. We have things like gravity. It's great. Why would you want to leave? I get this question fairly regularly, and I suppose I want to answer it in a bit of an unusual way. I want to introduce you to someone who probably would have understood why we want to go to Mars. It's this guy. You probably don't recognise him, but this is Edward White. He was an astronaut during the Gemini and Apollo programs. And you probably don't recognise him, looking very smart, you know, part of the Air Force, rah, rah, rah. Chances are, though, you've seen this photo of him. Ed White was the US's very first spacewalker. And Ed has one of the most wonderful quotes in history ever. During this spacewalk, he was supposed to be out there for 12 minutes. He stayed out there for 20. Not because he got stuck out or something went wrong, because they literally could not get him back in the capsule because he just wanted to stare at Earth from space. He just stayed out there. He ignored radio calls, and eventually they managed to convince him to come back in. And the quote from Ed just before he climbed back inside the capsule was, "This is the saddest moment of my life." Because he was literally saying goodbye to this giant, gorgeous blue ball. Now, chances are Ed would have been... Ed literally lived next door to Neil Armstrong. Like, he literally lived next door to the guy who was the first man on the moon.
That's one small step for man. One giant leap for mankind.
They were next door neighbours. Their wives hung out together. They worked together. Ed would have been one of the men who set foot on the moon. But he didn't. Ed, unfortunately, died alongside Gus Grissom and Roger Chaffee in the Apollo 1 fire. They had the capsule full of pure oxygen, they had an exposed wire inside, it sparked, and the three men were incinerated. But Ed still believed that his saddest moment of his life was when he had to come back out of space to climb back inside a capsule and leave the gorgeous environment that he was living in. He believed in exploration. He believed that he was involved with a massive project that was far bigger than himself, far bigger than his own well-being. He was willing to live, to risk life and limb, quite literally, to die in a fire on the launch pad well before they were actually supposed to be launching, weeks before, just as part of a routine test. But he was willing to take that risk because he knew what he was involved with would eventually put people on the moon, and his literal next-door neighbour was the man that first set foot on the moon. It's also about perspective. So Neil Armstrong was the first man on the moon, but he went up there and took 5 photos. And there's 2 photos of Neil Armstrong on the moon. Both of them, well, one of them taken by Neil himself and the other taken by Buzz Aldrin. The one that was taken by Buzz was as Neil was climbing back into the capsule from a distance. And you can barely make out where Neil Armstrong actually is. And the other photo is a reflection off Buzz Aldrin's helmet, and you can see where Neil Armstrong's taking the photo from there. So that classic photo that you see of an astronaut staring into the camera is actually of Buzz Aldrin. So Neil didn't deliberately take photos of himself. He didn't take any selfies on the moon. And what's interesting about all of this is the technology that got those men onto the moon were things like slide rules. Well before, like, they joked about computers fitting into a room, a single room. And yet the technology that they developed to put him on the moon is also inside her camera. The miniaturization of electronics was what made Apollo possible, and we've continued to apply that into our phones. And yet we go into a bathroom and take 37 photos of ourselves. It is literally all about perspective. It's about what you value and where the technology that we're using has actually come from. I bring it back to this, again, about being able to see the planet from above. And for so many people, it's about the ability to go and explore and discover more about the universe that we live in. It's not just about being able to see the gorgeous world that we've come from, but being able to look on to the next one and explore that as well. I want to leave you with a quote from Konstantin Tsiolkovsky, who was a Russian cosmist. He was the man who essentially was the father of modern rocketry. As it says, Earth is the cradle of humanity, but one cannot remain in the cradle forever. Mars One literally has the opportunity to go out and set foot, to move out of home. We may have gone to the moon, and it might have been a bit of a slumber party, go and hang out, you know, like you do when you're a kid. But this is like moving out of home for the first time and literally moving to a whole new planet and learning to live self-sufficiently for ourselves. So, before I disappear, because there's inevitably plenty of them, does anyone have any questions? Don't be shy.
just briefly, you mentioned the death
of Ed White. Yep.
From pure oxygen in the cabin. Was yep. that an incident, an accident, or an intentional?
At the time, so in terms of the pure oxygen that was in the actual capsule at the time, that was a standard operating procedure that they had. They would fill the capsule full of pure oxygen. And that way it simplified the breathing systems that the men are on. There's various different issues. If the guys were exposed to reduced air pressure, there was a possibility that the nitrogen that was in their bloodstreams would embolize, in the same way that scuba divers experience the bends and things like that. So they keep them breathing pure oxygen. What they did was they would simplify the systems so that the capsule itself was pure oxygen, and then the breathing systems were pure oxygen as well. After the fire, they changed it to 60% oxygen and 40% nitrogen, which is still incredibly flammable, but it reduced the risk that a simple short would actually incinerate the entire capsule. So, any more? Yeah?
What parameters are you using to narrow down 705 people?
What's the selection criteria for the 705? Essentially, the next stage for us is the interview. So we are going to be facing a selection panel of some of the top space psychologists in the world, people who were on the forefront of researching all these sort of things, working out how people operate in isolation, and essentially the psychological factors that go into that. So they're looking for people who not only fit those characteristics, but have the drive to leave Earth behind. Not just be MacGyver and do things here on Earth, but actually see the point of not just going to Mars, but the reason why you would want to stay there for good. And having that sense of purpose is one of the major factors that they're looking for. So from the 705, they'll narrow it to 24 of those people that suit that the best. Yeah.
When you were very little, did you I have dreams of going to space and all that sort of thing?
I did. When I was 7, I vividly remember Andy Thomas being selected as Australia's first professional astronaut in 1992 and seeing that on the news, turning around to my parents and going, Australians can do that? And they turned around and sort of went, well, not really. The reality was Andy Thomas had to change his citizenship. He had to become an American in order to join NASA in the first place. And the situation meant that Australia doesn't have a space agency and continues not to have a space agency, there's no way other than through an international organisation like Mars One for Australians to actually train and become astronauts without changing their citizenship, which is a bit of a shame. So
you were, at 7, you were like...
Vividly,
I want to do that.
Desperately wanted to do it and wasn't necessarily talked out of it, but was convinced that the opportunities weren't available. I went off, I became wrapped up with the idea of joining the army because my dad had been in the army. I went off, studied applied physics and psych at Curtin University and felt that I still loved science, but I wanted to work in the military. Served with the army for about 4 years, spent about 12 months with the British Commandos, and then went into stand-up comedy, as you do. But yeah, it was very much a case of I went off and I found over the years, looking back now, that so much of the different things that I did are jigsaw puzzle pieces wanting to do this. And it actually, there was a fairly startling realisation in 2010 that this is something that I'd always wanted to do. I'd literally forgotten about it since I was seven. So, yeah. Yeah, yeah.
What type of food are they looking at growing?
Ah, good question. So what kind of food? We want to maintain our, we want to be as sustainable as possible. So the idea is that we're independent from Earth. There will be reserve rations, there will be backup food, there should be enough food for about 6 years for us to survive there without any additional backup food, without anything. So we could literally survive based on the rations that we carry for about 6 years. 2 years after we get there, a new crew of four arrive, and 2 years after that, a new crew, and they're bringing backup rations with them all the time. What I didn't show you in the pictures earlier on was that there's two giant inflatable habitats that go out the back of those colonies. The front half of that is our living quarters, and the back half of that is essentially grown food. So we'll be growing our own food. It means essentially going vegan, which genuinely horrifies me, and I'm making up for it as much as I can at the moment by eating as much bacon and eggs as I possibly can. Because the only potential protein source that we're talking about is maybe possibly taking insects, taking grasshoppers and crickets and cockroaches and ants and all sorts of things, because they're small and easy to maintain.
But surely you'd be able to get some sort of high protein seed that could survive conditions that's green?
We could grow food for sure, but in terms of the animals that we might take up there, crickets and grasshoppers are by far the highest protein source that we can take, and they're very easy to grow and keep as well. So we could go entirely plants, but chances are we'll take animals up there, not just for a food source, but also for experimenting on how they reproduce and things like that. It'll teach us more about how we might reproduce. Yeah.
What's the overall intention? What's the grand vision?
Surviving. I joke, but it is primarily focused towards leaving Earth. It's primarily focused about setting up an off-world colony that humans live on. We last went to the moon 42 years ago, and we've never been back since. We've never explored further than low Earth orbit in the last 42 years. So by going one way and setting up a colony, it's quite literally a beacon of humanity calling the young people, calling people of all ages to go out and explore the universe. And again, I come back to the perspective thing. It's about providing a perspective where you have 7, 8-year-old kids having Mars pointed out to them and then being told there's people up there. That's essentially what it's about. It's about having a launch pad to go on and explore further. Yeah.
If you do get selected, what do you think will be the last things you say to your friends and family?
Thank you. That would probably be the first one. We're not cut off. That's important to sort of clarify. We're not completely cut off from Earth. So there's still communication backwards and forwards. The issue is in the delay. Because of the time that it takes light to travel from Earth to Mars, it's anywhere between 4 and 20 minutes. So if I called Mum up and said hello, it'd take at least 4 minutes to get to her. She'd say hello back, so I'd be waiting 8 minutes for a hello back. So it's all emails, it's all videos, all those sort of things. Pre-packaged, sent, received, sent back. So, yeah, my last words would probably be thank you for everything. But we're certainly not cut off at all. So there was another one down here somewhere. Yeah.
Why did you want to go to the...
Why do I want to go to Mars? That's a good question. For me, it's about exploring somewhere that people have never been before and setting up somewhere that people can go on and explore even further. If we go to Mars and we set up somewhere that people can live permanently, it makes it that much easier to keep exploring and go further. It's a chance for us to go from Mars and then go off to somewhere like Europa, one of the moons of Jupiter, or maybe go and explore Titan, or go even further again. So it's a footstep. It's our first foothold off Earth that we can go and explore the rest of the solar system and the universe.
Josh, water's going to be a big issue for you.
Yeah.
As I understand it, you're going to get oxygen from there, you're going to grow your food, you're going to keep yourself. Is there that much water there? And can you regain that energy deficiency-wise?
There's an extraordinary amount of water on Mars. The reality is it's all locked up in the soil. About 2 billion years ago, Mars looked very much like Earth did. It had oceans, it had all those sort of things as well. The reality is it hasn't just disappeared into space, it's frozen in the soil. So for us, the biggest challenge for us is getting sufficient power. So one of the photos I didn't show you is essentially an overview of the entire base, and the amount of solar power that we're taking up there is extraordinary. Because we need to extract that water out of the soil, we then need to process that water so that we can use it for drinking, break it down for oxygen, all those sort of things. The priority is about finding soil that is saturated with ice. And from what we've seen from Viking 1 and 2, it looks highly likely that the area that we're going to land in, which is very close to Viking 1 and 2, there is extraordinary amounts of water there as well. So it's just a case of being able to process it and get it out. And that's what the 2018 lander is all about testing. It's sending solar panels out, it's digging it up, and it's checking it. So, on the end, yeah.
The rocket technology and fuel strategy, is that based on, together in 10 years' time, I mean, is that based on what's available now or what's to be predicted to be available?
Everything we're doing is using existing technology. One of the hurdles that many of the previous Mars missions have run into is where they've turned around and said, we will go and do this when we have such and such technology and we need to develop this technology for the mission. And the reality is they get sidetracked and that technology never ends up being used. What Mars One has turned around and said, what do we have available right now? And what can we use and what will it cost in order to get to Mars one way? And that's... There's a possibility that would change and adapt and adjust, but chances are we'll be using the most reliable and the most established technology rather than trying to use things that are experimental. There's a possibility that for the future colonists who come along and follow us behind every 2 years afterwards, that they might bring updated technology, they might bring other options. But for us, the primary focus is using what's available right now to get there, rather than hoping that we might have something in the future. I'm gonna, in the middle there, yeah.
What technologies do you plan to bring to your mission?
What technologies are we planning to bring? So some of the interesting technologies that we're looking at are things like hydroponics and aquaponics so that we can grow all our food and potentially maybe even bring fish along with us as well. One of the really interesting ones is the idea of using parts, all the equipment that we use, have it be 3D printed. You don't want to try and take up 5 spares for something and then run out and not be able to use it. So you want to have parts that you can 3D print so that you literally have something gets updated or changed, they just fax over, they just email you the new designs and you print it out and you can repair the equipment from there. So that's one of the big technologies that we're looking at. The other one is new types of solar panels. So that lander that I showed you before is actually a flexible rollout solar panel. There's the two big round ones, which are exactly the same as what NASA used in 2005 on their Phoenix lander. But the rollout solar panel is the new technology that we want to test as well. But most of it is established stuff rather than developing new things. The back.
What's going to happen if somebody falls pregnant up there?
What if we have a little Martian? The reality is we won't have the resources to look after a child up there. And Mars One have spoken about this a little bit recently. The reality is they can't turn around and say you need to be sterilised, but they have said that if you were unable to have children, it would actually make you a better candidate. Because the reality is, we don't want to have kids up there. We don't know what shape a child would take because we're used to having a fetus develop in 1G of gravity and all of a sudden you're talking about a child maybe being developing in zero G or one third. You don't know what the bone structure would take on. There's all kinds of very challenging questions. So for the first three or four crews, at least, so for the first 6 to 8 years that we actually have people on Mars, the experiments are going to be focused towards other animals, testing to see, you know, whether or not crickets can fall pregnant in the first place. What we've seen from experiments on the International Space Station is that actually becoming pregnant is incredibly challenging. So a lot of the fertilisation process requires gravity for things to move in the right direction that they need to. So just falling pregnant could be incredibly challenging, but we're going to try and avoid it in the first place. Yeah.
Josh, will you be in a space suit the whole time? There won't be a situation where you'll have any gravity, is that right?
So once we're on Mars, any time that we're inside the capsules, there's no need to wear a suit. One of the biggest challenges for us will be anytime we go outside, you have to wear a suit. And the reality is, because of the radiation on Mars, there's a really good chance that anytime you do go outside, it'll have to be at night time as well, because of the amount of solar radiation that is present. You want to literally have an entire planet between you and the sun to provide some protection. When we're inside the capsules, it's normal dress. There's no issue like that. So we're not going to be stuck in those spacesuits all the time. And when we're on Mars, we're still in one third gravity as well. So we've still got some gravity. Yeah.
How long do you need to be to get into...
I think you should probably check that with your mum and dad. You need to be 18 to apply in the first place. And the youngest applicant that we have is 18 years old. The oldest applicant that we still have in the running is 71 years old. He's certainly not the oldest that applied. The oldest was an 82-year-old who would have been 91 by the time they got to Mars. But you have to be 18 to apply in the first place, and then after that, you have to do 9 years of training. So you're probably the youngest people that are going to be there will be maybe 30. In my case, I am probably going to have my 40th birthday on Mars if I go as part of the first crew. Yeah.
I know it's going to be a dangerous mission, right? But let's say, do you think there's life there? And if there's life there, if there's a threat, do you need to carry your lightsaber?
Do I need to worry about little green men?
sorry to interrupt.
There are.
Yeah, if there's water there, could there not be also?
So life is obviously something that we would love to find. It's a two-way street when it comes to looking and finding life on Mars. The UN actually has some laws that are in place called COSPA, which is about the prevention of contamination of other heavenly bodies. So essentially, it's about protecting Mars from us and about protecting us from Mars as well. So in our case, we're actually going to be landing in a place called Chrysis Planitia, which is far up in the north of Mars, well away from caves and valleys and things like that, out on the plains. And the idea is by landing out there, the chances of squashing something or being attacked by something are very, very, very low. You're way out in the plains, exposed to radiation. We're going to be digging underground to provide more radiation protection. But we want to land out somewhere where we're not going to squash anything. It'd be kind of like aliens landing in the middle of the Sahara to try and avoid running into anybody. That said, what we'll probably end up doing is operating robots that will then go and explore those areas. Sterilised robots that aren't going to carry germs from us, because humans are filthy, and it won't be carrying, it'll be sterilised to prevent any kind of contamination, and then we'll take samples from those areas and analyse them and keep them quarantined to be able to determine whether or not anything we find has come from Earth or Mars in the first place. One of the interesting theories that came out very recently was the idea that we may be Martian. That Mars may have been the genesis of life, and we've shown that things can essentially survive in the vacuum of space, and potentially have life forms move from Mars over to Earth on asteroid impacts and things like that, ejected rock being thrown and then coming back down to Earth. So there's a possibility that we're Martian. It's a very exciting idea, and it would radically change the way that we would see ourselves as human by finding life on the next planet over. So.
Things like sterilisation, you know, that's sterilisation as we know it on Earth, but that doesn't necessarily mean it's sterilisation.
Very true.
On Mars.
Very true. So we don't know what form life on Mars might take, if we find any at all. Astrobiology is a fascinating subject, and there's so many unknowns in all of it. All we can do is the best that we can do. We can try and sterilise things as best as we possibly can, but we still make mistakes as well. So it's better to go and explore and potentially make a mistake and sort of go, oh, actually we found out that life has this other form instead, and potentially accidentally kill it, than never even find out about it in the first place.
Well, that's actually one of my bigger, other questions is, like, overall, the space exploration, you know, what is the hope that it's going to bring universally, you know, to, like, is there hope that it's going to bring something universally to benefit the Earth, or is it...
Absolutely. And to be honest with you, my main focus in doing this is that... is about the benefits that it'll bring to Earth. People talk about how expensive space exploration is, and yet for every dollar that the US puts into space exploration, they get 10 back. For every euro that the European Union puts into space exploration, they get 3 back. So there's the financial elements. For me, the bigger push is the cultural impacts, the potential to actually change the way that we see ourselves as humans. I talked a little bit earlier on about the overview effect, where astronauts get to see Earth from above and they see that there's no borders, there's no nations, we are one species. And by having more people experience that and have more people turn around and say, hey, there's you know, people from all different countries living together peacefully on Mars, that will hopefully break down some of the nationalism and some of the some of the awful things that humans do to each other. We certainly do. We're having real issues at the moment. Yeah.
Will the colonists actually have any legal rights or, like, naming something? Like, you're the first person to climb the Skilla Mountain, will that become Josh's Hill?
That would be awesome. I want to call something Josh's Hill. That'd be great. The reality is no one can stop you. You're 56 million kilometres away from every other human being. I call it whatever I want to call it. One of the interesting things Mars One's talked about is a way to try and raise revenue to make the mission happen is the idea of naming different things. Not necessarily things on Mars, but naming bits and pieces of the colony after various different businessmen that invest. So they've talked about, you know, calling the colony Gatestown if Bill Gates were to invest or something like that. There's options that way, but that said, who's going to tell you not to call it something when you are literally, you know, at your closest 56 million kilometres away from every other human being? Yeah.
Another thing too, if you get to go there, you reckon you'll put up a signpost like they had on MASH showing directions.
Oh, yes, yeah. I'm sure we'd pretty much just have one signpost pointing back to Earth, but then again, it moves around as well. So maybe some sort of mobile antenna that kind of points. We could just paint a big red arrow on the microwave transmitter back that's sending back all the footage of what we're doing. That's always going to be pointed back at Earth, so yeah.
Is there any resources that they're looking for there? Is there a risk that... Yeah, with that kind of talking about all the sponsorship stuff, that it's going to be bigger mining companies
worried about mining Mars. Yeah, well, it's something that's being talked about quite a bit. Asteroid mining is a really big thing that's being discussed quite a bit at the moment. The chances of us mining Mars are pretty low. It's much, much easier. The real moneymaker when it comes to looking at resources off Earth is asteroids. There's so many rare earth metals that are like asteroids just made out of these things that we call rare earth metals, and there's asteroids, lumps of rock that are just made out of them. The issue with going to somewhere like Mars and trying to mine it is you have to go down into that gravity well. You have to go and experience the gravity of Mars because it's so large, and then leave again and try and bring it back to Earth. The real moneymaker with things like going and exploring space is asteroid mining, because the gravity is so much lower. You can drag these things around and potentially push them around into an orbit around Earth and provide the resources that we need to build spacecraft already in space. So you can build spacecraft that are thousands of times bigger than what we have at the moment, because it doesn't have to go through the aerodynamic forces, the gravitational forces, to get to space, because it's been built in space in the first place. So there's extraordinary opportunities that way. I'm not too worried about people mining Mars, because it's too difficult. The whole planet's made out of iron ore, but what's the point of having iron ore when you have rocks in space already that are that much easier to get to, that are very unlikely to have any kind of life on? Whereas Mars is more like Antarctica. It's more like a place where we want to keep as pristine as possible and protect. And so our colony is about trying to protect that, have people there to research it, but try and protect it as best we can, in the same way that we try and protect the Antarctic as best we can. Yeah.
Is there anything at this point that could change your mind about going to Mars?
Is there anything that could change my mind at this moment? I'm not thinking of very much. if things changed, the reality is at the moment they are, Mars One's saying that this is happening, and the best of my background, the best of my knowledge is that they will continue to do that. If that was no longer the case, if they misled candidates in some way or shape or form or whatever, then I'd adjust to that at that stage. But I have given up a lot already to get as far as I have. I can't think of much that would sway me out of it. Yeah.
Now, you said that you're going to have to do an interview.
Yes.
I've done interviews before where you want to try and tell them what they want to hear. But then that's backfired.
Yep.
Are you going to tell them what they want to hear?
I'll tell them who I am. I will tell them who I am. Because, again, going back to the Lisa Nowak thing, if you tell them what you think they want to hear, they're going to find out very quickly if you've lied to them. You lock someone away in a mock-up colony for 3 months and you find out all kinds of things about them very, very quickly. That kind of high-pressure environment where you're in this little cooker, this pressure cooker, for 3 months at a time, all the personality flaws, all the background comes out, and it's all being filmed as well. So that's the real interview.
if you're the right person, you will get selected effectively.
Yeah. You'll essentially, they're starting with, they're not even sure if they get 24 people. Out of the 200,000 that applied, they're still not even sure if they'll actually get 24 that they think would be appropriate. That's what they're aiming for. Maybe I won't suit it, I don't know. But until I get that far and get thrown into an analogue to find out, I won't know. And that's the reality for many, many people. I've seen it in the past where the time that I spent with the British Commandos, we had so many guys at the start so convinced that they were going to go all the way through. Commando training is about 8 months in the UK. And guys right at the start, dead set convinced that they were going to make it all the way through. I was dead set convinced that I was going to make it all the way through. I got about three quarters of the way through and discovered that I could do the job. I was very good at the job. I didn't want to do the job. And that's the reality for a lot of people. Until you're actually in an environment where you're practicing to do it, you won't truly know whether or not you are suited to it in the first place.
The difficulty with this is not about you as an individual. You're going to have to be compatible with whoever else
yeah.
is going.
Absolutely. So compatibility compatibility between the crew members is something that will sort itself out naturally while also being assisted by the psychologists that are following us all the time. There was quite a bit of discussion about how crews were assigned during the Apollo program by Deke Slayton, the head of the astronaut corps in the US, because everyone talked about it being this mysterious process. I'm currently reading Neil Armstrong's biography at the moment, and all Deke was doing was matching the right people with the right kind of jobs. And they are essentially going to be doing the same thing. You see who spends time together, who lives next door to each other, people who naturally want to spend time with each other, and then you find out whether or not they have the appropriate skill set to do what you're asking them to do as well. So it'll naturally sort itself out with assistance.
You both want to provide the skills afterwards.
Well, the idea is to get the right people and then train them. So we've got 9 years of training. In that period of time, you can train someone to be both an engineer and a doctor. You can train people to be whatever you need them to be, provided they have the right personality to do it in the first place. So, yeah.
Who's funding this?
So it's being funded itself. Essentially, there's a variety of different sources. One of the big ones is having it televised. The 2012 Olympics in the UK in London raised $4.5 billion in 3.5 weeks with TV broadcast rights. We're talking about broadcasting the astronaut selection, like the selecting the 24 people, what they're doing in training, you know, the selection process as they start to narrow the group down, the launch, the first footfall on Mars. It's pretty incredible television, incredible potential for television. Again, people sort of worry about the reality TV side of things with that, but that's not the only source of income. There's other things like intellectual property. There'll be certain technologies that are developed as part of the process for this mission to actually happen that they'll then have intellectual property rights on. Private investment, a variety of different things. Crowdfunding, I have some merchandise outside that if people want to buy Mars One t-shirts, you can buy Mars One t-shirts. So yeah, there's a variety of different sources. The big thing is public interest. If people want to watch it and want to be involved, then there are ways to fund it. And that's essentially what we're seeing at the moment. If the TV show starts in early next year, like they're talking about, Mars One has just signed a deal with Endemol, who are the producers of Big Brother and all those sort of things. People worry about the Big Brother thing again. The production house that's actually handling Mars One is the same people that did Touching the Void. So rather than focusing on, you know, let's see what stupid challenge we can get someone to do in some ridiculous fabricated house, it will be a far more realistic approach to this is what we actually need to do on Mars and how is it going to work, rather than just let's stick them together and see who's going to kill each other.
Is there like a scientific investment in this? Because I get the whole people want to watch it.
Yep.
But where is the scientific?
So there's huge amounts of research that come out of all of this as well. By recording and broadcasting it, this is the sort of thing that space psychologists have to pay for the research to do in the first place. And here we are potentially having all of this research being open broadcast for people to be involved with as well. So there's opportunities in psychology, in particular, huge opportunities in psychology. There's also the possibility of people watching it and looking at the systems that are being used and having the people who are in the mock-up colonies describe what systems they're using and having other engineers turn around and go, oh, he's having an issue with that, and try and find a solution from there. So it's about opening up ideas and showing what we're trying to do and having people get involved with that as well. Yeah.
So what's your next step with the program?
My next step is essentially the interview. We were told, all 705 of us were told that we'd passed our medicals in April, and we've been waiting for the interview ever since. Essentially, the interviews are all being broadcast as part of the TV show. So we've waited for the contract to be signed, and Mars One is currently working out exactly where they're going to be at what time for those interviews. I'm hoping that it's not next month, because I'm spending the next 6 weeks travelling around visiting all the European Space Agency facilities. If it is next month, I am going to be upsetting a lot of people and having to cut my trip short to come back to Sydney. So, yeah.
Do you get any
in terms of the technology that we might take, or yeah. Awesome.
Of course, you've got to provide food for them, so you've got to grow mulberries there, so you can grow them like fondly. So there's two food sources.
It's an ongoing process with all of it. I'm actually involved with the Lander Challenge. There's a university challenge that Mars One has put out. They have payload space on their 2018 lander, and they are asking universities to submit potential payloads that they'll send on that first lander. There will be opportunities for people to be involved every step of the way. All of this is about public involvement. So if I were one of the people who started training, we wouldn't just be learning new things, we would also be trying to find solutions to the problems that Mars One would be facing. So one of them might be all those sort of things. So it's not just you've got to learn how to be a doctor and you've got to learn how to be an engineer and all this sort of thing. It's about you have to do all of those things and be incredibly versatile and solve the solution, find solutions to the problems that Mars One have in order to get people to Mars in the first place. So one back there? No, we'll go in the middle.
Reversing back to the lady Lisa who tried to murder her girlfriend.
Yes, Lisa Nowak.
Because one of the things I was just thinking about that, because she obviously went somewhere and came back, was that it?
She was on a flight, she went to space, shortly after she returned, she tried to meet this woman that was sleeping with the guy that she was sleeping with. She tried to meet her at the airport. She actually drove an extraordinary distance from where they were in Houston to try and abduct this woman at the airport.
Okay, because one of the things I was going to say about that is it possible that given all the changes and fluctuations in the body chemistry from that flight in space, that then readjusting to the Earth, the integrity between the physical, emotional and mental bodies, you'd obviously have that readjustment. And personally, as a female as well, I can understand, you know, when someone's hormones are all over the place, you know, it could turn extreme, you know, you could just, you know, stuff. So, you know, did it look interesting?
It sounds vaguely like you're justifying homicide. I just...
I'm justifying it on the basis of clinical chemical imbalance.
One of the big factors with all of this is we just don't know. We've had just over 500 people go to space in the entire history of humanity. We just don't have enough data about that side of things. From what we've seen, going to space has incredible physiological and psychological impacts on people. Generally, in terms of the psychological aspect, it's actually the reverse of what you're talking about. It makes people more open, makes them more grateful and appreciative. Astronauts, again, coming back to that perspective side of things, they have a larger perspective on the world that they live in, and they develop a really deep-seated desire to make things better. Ron Garan in particular was a US astronaut who started Fragile Oasis, which is a huge organisation that's currently trying to essentially look after the fragile oasis that we live on. Amazing work. There's so many people who've managed to witness Earth from space are radically changed by it, and it's almost always for the better. The reality with Lisa Nowak was that she probably shouldn't have flown in the first place, and she certainly shouldn't have had the relationship that she had. She was actually sleeping with another astronaut, and she found out that another woman had started sleeping with him as well. And that aspect, those kind of psychological pressures, you wouldn't want to be sending someone like that to Mars in the first place. It comes back to integrity, and it comes back to the ability to trust the people that you're going with, and the people who are supporting you on the ground. So, yeah.
I understand that, and those people that come back have that perspective, but they're coming back. Obviously, when you're over there and you're going to stay there, your perspective is going to be completely different.
Yes. So I suppose the focus for the people who do go to Mars, for the colonists, it's about you have that exploration spirit, that explorer's spirit, where you're essentially, I don't know if people are familiar with Joseph Campbell, with the hero with 1,000 faces, but this idea of the hero's monomyth, where you essentially go out, you go and discover something great, you go and get the treasure or whatever, and then you come back again. This is cutting that in half. And those people are literally staying out there on the adventure for the rest of their lives. They have the opportunity to literally explore a whole new planet that no one has ever set foot on before, and continue to explore. And it's about not just going somewhere and then coming back. We have the opportunity to go there, share what we discover with Earth, and call others to come and join us on this amazing adventure and continue on for the rest of our lives to explore. So that's the focus, rather than going to space and then looking back and going, how wonderful did we have it and we didn't even realise it. It's a case of, we recognise how wonderful it is, but we want to go out and explore, and we'd like you to come with us as well. Yeah.
How will the crew get around language barriers?
Language barriers. It sounds very imperialistic, very focused on sort of, you know, English backgrounds, and it sounds like it's focused towards TV audiences and things like that, but the language will be English. It's not because of the TV aspect or anything like that. English is the language of the space industry. People who work in the space industry anywhere in the world speak English, as a general rule. There has been a lot of work between Russia and the US to try and cross boundaries in that way. So a lot of people who go up to the International Space Station spend a lot of time learning Russian, because the Russians still produce all of their manuals in Russian. But as a general rule, English is the language of the space industry. And in that case, the official language will be English. That doesn't mean that people couldn't apply in other languages initially. Mars One accepted any one of 16 very commonly spoken languages during the application process. It's just an assumption, it's just an expectation that any candidate who was taking it seriously, by the time they got to interview, would have learnt and developed their English to a level where they could easily communicate with the interviewers.
You've got those 9 years
in. But even prior to the start of those 9 years training, you would expect that someone would learn the language so that they can communicate with the interviewers that are taking them on in the first place. Last one. Will they be in charge? The issue with having someone in charge is you've then got someone to hate when it all starts to go horribly wrong. You do need to have elements of leadership, but it's also quite a fluid aspect. What most people going up to the International Space Station do in the way that they're trained is, rather than having someone who is the actual leader, you practice leadership and followership as well. So someone might be specialised in one particular area and they take responsibility for that, and the other crew members support them. And then someone else might take the leadership role in something else. So it's about the particular situation. There may be some sort of commander role, but that would all come down to how the crew wanted to work together. You may have ground control turn around and saying, you know, you should do this, you should do that, but there's no way to enforce it. You are 4 light minutes away from Earth, and it's not like they're going to tell you to come back home again. So it's all about those 4 people working out how things work out for the best of themselves. It's 8:25, folks. So thank you all very much for coming along this evening. It's been wonderful performing this and being able to share what I'm doing with the people of Perth. So I really appreciate you all coming along tonight, and thank you for the wonderful questions as well. If you are interested, I've got a few t-shirts and a few posters and things like that left over. I also have a mountain of the Becoming Martian posters, which you're free to take if you like, because this is the final show. So thank you all for coming along tonight. Big round of applause for our amazing film crew at the back there. My name's Josh Richards, thank you very much.